We're back now with the Washington Post columnist David Ignatius, who is just back from Afghanistan, by the way, and Michael O'Hanlon, the senior fellow at Brookings, an expert on national security and terrorism in general. Well, gentlemen, we just saw basically a snapshot of where this debate is right now, and obviously I don't see any consensus at this point on where people think the president ought to go on this.
Certainly, the view of Senator McConnell is you ought to follow military advice. If the military wants the troops, you ought to send them. I thought we heard from Senator Reid a very clear statement of where the president and his inner group are. They want to look at this. They want to think clearly about strategy. They want to match the goals in Afghanistan with the number of troops necessary to achieve those goals. And I think that's been the tricky thing. It's not they want to shortchange the troops. They want to make sure that the troops fit the strategic goal. And I think they're still working that through. My own feeling is that the American people after Iraq are going to tolerate that kind of careful review because nobody wants to rush in again to a war without fully understanding the costs and the consequences.
Michael, you have sort of been charting this war in both Iraq and Afghanistan for a long, long time. Where is it now? We hear from one side it's urgent, we have to act now. The other side says maybe we ought to think about this a little bit. How would you just assess the situation now?
Well, Bob, it's a good question because I think some of the disagreement now about what to do is people's impressions of how fast we're losing. General McChrystal says pretty fast. He says the Taliban are now in 140 of Afghanistan's 368 districts, and they used to be in just a couple of dozen. And they've got momentum. People are not necessarily supporting them, liking them, but they are afraid of them. And they appreciate that they have the momentum on the battlefield. So a lot of Afghan tribes are putting some fighters with the Taliban just to hedge their bets. On the other hand, you have some people in the administration who are implicitly saying, we got some time. Let's let the Afghans do more of the fighting. Let's be patient. Let's train them up and, you know, wait until they're able to do. They don't put it quite that way, but implicitly they're saying we've got a little more time than General McChrystal may be arguing. And so, frankly, if you look at the evidence, there has been progress in Afghanistan in the last 8 years. There are a lot more kids in school. There's better health care. There's a higher GDP. But the battlefield momentum is on the side of the Taliban. There really is no mistaking that. And the simplest way to say it is they're now in control or prevalent in at least a third of the country's districts.
And David, just as we saw this weekend, when the Taliban can go in and invade the army headquarters in Pakistan, it tells you that they are also a force to be reckoned with there. How serious is that?
Bob, I was just in Pakistan. I wasn't in Afghanistan, but I was there just over a week ago. I was in that same army compound in Rawalpindi where these Taliban insurgents managed to sneak in and hold hostages. What I saw in Pakistan is a country that is trying to get serious about the Taliban insurgency, the threat that Pakistanis at senior levels in the military and the government understand threatens the way they want to live in Pakistan. I went to Swat Valley where they've had a big offensive all summer. They're proud of what they did. You know, it's not perfect, but they're proud of it. I went to Waziristan, which is where Al-Qaeda's safe havens are, and I saw the troops who are getting ready, I'm told, to start an offensive maybe next week. So they're getting serious about it, but even as they mount these offensives, they're getting pounded in their own capital with these car bombs, with these attacks in Rawalpindi, and it frightens them. I think one final thing they worry about is America really going to stick around? They watch our debate, and they worry. The Americans may be gone, and we'll be left with this. What are we going to do about it? I think if there's one signal the White House would want to send is, and I think President Obama tried to do this last week, we are not going to bail out. You know, whatever we decide, we're not going to walk away.
Well, what about this this whole thing that, and you get these reports, you get them, I get them, we all get them, that they're now talking about, well, maybe we should rethink the Taliban. Maybe we should look for some way to seek some sort of an accommodation with them in order to focus more on Al-Qaeda.
Well, you know, this is where we're hearing this middle option for Afghanistan develop. This is one of the ideas behind a so-called middle option. We don't have to increase troops. You know, this, however, is inherent to General McChrystal and General Petraeus's concept already. Now, there may be better ways to do it. We may be sloppy in the implementation. But people who are saying, let's try to find Taliban we can negotiate with, this is not new. President Karzai has been trying to do this the whole time he's been in office. And the essence of the Petraeus strategy in Iraq was trying to do this. McChrystal's trying to do it now, too. A lot of the question is, do you do that from a position of strength by trying to retake momentum on the battlefield with more troops, if need be, or do you hope that you can find some middle ground with this group that is so adamantly against women's role in modern life, against technology, against so many of the things we're associated with here in the West. And I tend to prefer the position from strength approach. I think they are only going to be impressed when we start to get some momentum.
Do you think, David, that if the Taliban comes back, that there's a chance that Al-Qaeda may not, that they may go elsewhere, or are these
If the Taliban is part of a broad coalition government that it doesn't control, where it understands their rules of this game, I think there's a good chance of keeping Al-Qaeda out. Al-Qaeda is really not present in Afghanistan now, at least I haven't seen it, evidence of it on my trips. I thought Senator Reid said something really important during our discussion when he talked about getting Taliban off the battlefield without having to go out and kill them one by one. And he said that's what General Petraeus did in Iraq. And that basically means, let's be honest, negotiating with mid-level, lower-level commanders, village by village, to take them out of the battle. I think that is what they're trying to do, as Mike says. And, you know, that's how many troops does that take? That's what they're discussing in the White House right now.
Well, is that basically what Vice President Biden, is that the position that he's taking? And he's arguing when he says, you know, we use the drone aircraft to go after Al-Qaeda. As we begin to move, as you say, off the battlefield.
You know, I don't totally understand Vice President Biden's position. He hasn't been as public on it lately, and so I don't want to infer too much. But I do have qualms about the so-called counterterrorism option, because it presumes that we can somehow keep all these bases and keep our intelligence networks to carry out these strikes as we lose the war on the ground otherwise. You know, how do you keep human intelligence networks? How do you use air bases to fly drones if you don't have a government you can work with that's in control of its own territory? If the Taliban come back, we're going to lose those air bases, and we're going to lose the intelligence networks, I think. And so the counterterrorism option, in a minimalist, narrow sense, doesn't work. It's what we tried under Rumsfeld, and it didn't work.
We have about 30 seconds. So, David, do you believe that the nuclear weapons in Pakistan are secure? Is the government there taking care of that?
There's no way for any outsider to be certain, but what I can say, having met several dozen senior Pakistani officers on this trip 10 days ago, is that the quality of their officer corps is first rate, and they take their responsibilities seriously. I think there are a lot of things to worry about in that country. That would be lower on my list than some other things.
All right. Well, thank you all very much for a very enlightening discussion.